Hey everyone, we'd like to welcome you to Baconsale.
No one's going to hear that.
How's it going?
Are they going to hear that over the raucous music in the background?
Does it not really fit the raucous music?
I thought
it was kind of, you know.
I'm using my head voice today.
That almost sounded like Mr. Rogers.
It's an experience.
Yeah, you been a good boy?
That's Mr. McFeely right there.
that was a terrible intro, Ken. I'm sorry.
That's
I love
the problem
you.
With children
that was terrible.
Today. They don't know who Mr.
I'm getting
Rogers
insulted
is.
Here.
I don't care. I'm talking about me. Shut up.
Sorry, Joel.
But kids these days don't even know Mr. Rogers. All they know is Daniel Tiger. Like,
yeah.
I was singing Who Are the People in Your Neighborhood? My daughter's like, Daniel Tiger. And I'm like, no.
And I think we can all agree that, let the record show, Joel hates his kids. I think we can all agree that the worst part of Mr. Rogers was the puppet show, right?
No.
It was the worst.
I loved Lady...
The redhead?
Tuesday.
Who's angry all the time?
King Friday and Lady... I can't remember her name.
No, I hated the puppet show. It was the worst part. I'd rather learn about a crayon factory.
You didn't like Make Believe Land?
No. Aww. Not at all. I was like, what sweater is he going to wear today?
Yeah, ironically, cardigan. I never watched it. But
you what?
I never really watched it.
Wow. Did you have a TV growing up?
I did. I watched T-Man. So.
There you go. Yeah, because I remember you shared the story that you sat in front of the TV
with
a sword
outfit.
And strange Speedo.
It's actually an adorable picture. I am like 3 feet from the television.
We should post
the television.
Picture on Baconsale.com.
I will if I can find it. And it's this little wooden chair, and I've got a shield and a sword, and I'm staring at the television. And
he shared this in the last show as well.
I did not.
And two shows ago.
I did?
Fine.
Yeah, for the hero one.
Yeah, you said your mom took a picture.
Like
it's
getting a little ridiculous that you've mentioned it so many times at this point.
I'm going to bring it up again now.
You're teasing. Unless you post it on Baconsale.com, the audience is going to feel like you're teasing.
All right, I will try and post it.
So should I redo that intro?
No, it's good.
No, it's good.
It's fine.
I was just trying to be a little soothing because usually we're like, Baconsale.
Well, it may be a little soothing because people got passionate about our last episode, the fast food episode.
Yeah.
We need to calm them down a bit.
A little weird. I mean, we knew that, you know, fast food is fun to talk about. It's almost like Disney because everyone has experienced it.
Yes.
But wow, people got really opinionated.
Yeah, I was going to say, I got a lot of comments about my Wendy's comments and about my In-N-Out. Had some In-N-Out cult members, you know, try and kidnap
it's
me.
It's fresh.
Yeah, it's so fresh. Also, I do have an item of business. I misspoke last episode and I need to make a retraction.
Wow, we've never done this. I mean, we usually misspeak and we have fact checkers,
yeah,
but we never usually apologize.
But then we just laugh.
But I
so I think this is a bit of weakness for you right now, but that's fine. Move along.
It's because it's from my wife.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Weakness.
I was speaking on behalf of my wife when I was talking about Burger King, and I said that, their burgers are fantastic. You know, she loves those. Not true. She texted me. I'll just read her text right now. It says, quote, wrong. Burger King burgers are not fantastic. They're super dry without tons of sauce. I demand a retraction. I have a reputation to uphold, close quote.
Did you sleep on the couch that night?
I did, but it's because I was playing Batman.
Understood.
That's good.
Do you ever do that where you're like playing video games? I know you're just, you know, you play video games now sporadically.
Yes.
But you'll be playing video games, and Jake, I'm sure you've done this because you often play for like 9 hours in a row.
Never done that.
But where I'll be on the couch, and it'll be like 2:30 in the morning, and I'm like, you know what? It's too much effort. You're like going to bed right now. I'm just going to lay here on the couch.
Oh, I fall asleep on the couch all the time watching movies or watching TV.
Yeah.
My wife has pretty much given up on waking me up because she'll know I'll stumble upstairs usually around 3 or 4 and be like, arr.
And you wake up and your neck is all crick, and it's the worst.
I've never done that, actually.
It feels so...
Really?
Really, really. No, my wife will just stay up and play with me, actually.
But I mean, it feels so good to fall asleep on the couch and not have to get all ready for bed.
It feels good.
It feels great.
I don't even have to brush my teeth at night.
To drift off to sleep. But then it's always it's like horrible consequences in the morning. It's always like, oh, I did not sleep well.
Yeah.
My neck hurts.
And I'm very tall. I'm sure I don't know how big your guys' couches are. But like, I always have to sleep in like do fetal position if I ever sleep on the couch.
That's how I always sleep.
Oh, that's adorable.
Thumb sucking in the fetal position.
Okay, let's get into the episode here.
Oh, that's right. We have something. We have an episode.
Any other apologies you want to make to me right now? For being wrong at all?
Or to me?
No, never.
Probably to me.
No.
Probably to Jake. I mean, you basically told him he didn't know how to use the internet.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is true.
Yeah, it's true.
He tried to get after me online, and he couldn't.
What?
That works on two levels
right
there.
That's pretty funny. I got to admit that.
All right, so in case you didn't know, 5 minutes into the show, this is Baconsale.
Yes.
I'm Kent.
I'm Joel.
And Jacob.
And today we're talking about, well...
Yeah, you intro it, kid, because this is your baby.
This is your mind.
I mean, I feel like the blame is going back to me on this one.
Well, you know, if this episode fails, we'll know where to put the blame. So.
Yeah, except for the last one did really well, so can I take the credit?
No.
Okay.
I don't think so. No, that was definitely execution.
Not how it works.
So I'm going to infer a lot, and I'm not going to say anything specifically, but I think you can assume that you know where this is going, because we're going to play a game.
I want
to
play a game.
Where we take three movies, and we're hoping to make them comparable or thematic, mm-hmm. and just not all over the place. Or it could be like preference, for right. example. We're going to take three movies, and we're going to kill one or no. erase it.
Yeah, you've already watched it.
I've already ruined it. We're going to erase a movie from existence, like we'd never have seen it.
Yes.
Which means it's probably, if it's a movie we love, we have to say, I would never even know that that movie exists, and
not
that would make
us.
Me quite sad. Or
anyone.
Humanity.
Yeah.
We have to, there's one movie that you watch on cable.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we can, even though many people don't have cable anymore, we all understand, hey, this movie's on cable, I'm going to watch it.
It's like a 24/7 bat movie.
Well, you have to understand, it's low quality, but you don't care.
Yeah, standard definition. You there are it. Commercials, but you could walk in at any point in the movie. And yeah. this is probably one of your favorites. Could be a guilty pleasure. Just could be one that you've watched since you were a kid. Mm. You could turn it on at any point and just be like, boom, watch until the end.
Yep.
I like
even though you may have the DVD sitting next to the TV.
Of
you're
course.
Still just like, it's on.
And, yeah. and shout out to Dan. I liked what he said, which was, this is the movie that brings you joy.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah. And lastly.
Yep.
IMAX. IMAX is the movie that you leave the house for. You may step out and dress up.
You're going to pay top dollar for this, too.
Yes. But it's a movie that you want to see on the big screen. It could be spectacle. And, Joel, I know you have a slightly different interpretation than I do for this.
Yes.
Which, do you mind going into that?
Well, okay, so the
it's
game...
It's definitely spectacle.
Just to, by the way, encapsulate what Kent just said. The game we're playing is Cable IMAX Erase.
Yes.
Jake's going to give us three movies. We then have to determine which one we'd watch on cable, which one we'd watch on IMAX, and which one we would erase from existence. Now, Kent and I had a
And not just our minds, right? We want to clarify
existence.
That. Existence.
Yeah,
like, it was
yeah,
never even
never
made.
That's a lot of power.
It is.
That's Baconsale.
But Kent and I disagreed on one thing where we were trying to figure out what the top level was, if there are tiers here.
Well, not quite tiers.
They're not tiers, but it's more, I considered cable to be the highest honor. Because I'm like, this is something you'll always watch. You know, IMAX is just something that you'll watch occasionally, if that. And Kent was like, no, IMAX, that's the biggest movie. That's the best movie. So there is some disagreement there on
that. IMAX is the experience that it's like the, it could be the edgy movie, it could be the spectacle. It's the one that you want to experience maybe once, maybe twice in your life that you don't want to watch repeatedly because it may actually get annoying after a while. Like, let's say it's a Transformers movie. That may be your IMAX movie
mm-hmm.
because it's big and loud and you need to see it that way.
Yep.
Whereas you would not want to watch that repeatedly. And granted, Transformers you'd probably erase, but we'll get there.
Yeah,
indeed.
So Jake has a list. I have submitted some to trip up Kent.
Yeah.
Kent has submitted some to trip up me.
Indeed.
But Jake has the master list, and Jake is going to be reading these off, and then we are going to determine which ones we would watch on cable, which ones we would watch on IMAX, and which ones we would erase from existence.
Yeah. See if you can draw any parallels with this game with anything else.
I think I kind of ruined it to begin with.
Yeah, you did.
But, you know, like, for example, let me restate. Cable is standard definition. It's nice.
It's fine.
You watch it every once in a while. That's all I'm going
to
say.
It's the one you want to commit to.
IMAX is when you get dressed up and you leave the house for.
No.
Good. Okay, let's go. Let's do this.
Spell it out.
Play right. No,
play,
Jake.
Play along at home, will you, please?
Yeah. Hey, play along at home. And also, by the way, review us on iTunes. It's been a while since we've got a 5-star, so make it happen.
Doesn't have to be a 5-star. Give us your honest rating.
5 stars.
And then we also like reviews. It's great to write, to do a star rating, but we also like reviews on iTunes. And it really helps us out to get noticed on iTunes if we have a lot of ratings and reviews.
So, Jake, what I want to know in this game
is
every question for the two of us to answer,
yes.
or are you going to pick?
No, I was actually thinking about that before, and though some are especially designed for one or the other, you both have to do it. So if one is designed for you, Kent, then maybe Joel doesn't take quite as long, you know, explaining.
Oh, but we both have to answer?
But you both have to answer.
No, I didn't want to do that.
I never take
I gave them options that I would not have to answer.
No, I did it knowing full well they would come back.
Ah, crap.
And I'm going to go ahead and tell you who this Kent is. There's one of them. If we were just going to do one, you made that for Joel, but I was planning just to give that one to you and make you do it.
That's not cool. I'm not ready for this.
Well, let's jump into it then.
All right, who wants to go first?
Joel.
Okay.
Big Fish. Okay. It's a Wonderful Life.
Oh.
And About Time.
Oh. Wow. This is harder than I thought it was going to be. I love all those movies. Okay. Well, oh, man, that's difficult.
Yeah, I thought I might just give you some hard ones right off the bat. I've got a hard one for Kent, too.
Okay. Well, I mean, I'm going to have to do this fairly quick because we don't have a lot of time. We have a lot of movies to get through.
We have an hour.
I know, but I don't want to take too much time thinking about it. But the truth is, I love all of those movies, like, passionately. But I'm going to have to say that I'm going to... Oh, God. This is hard. Okay. The one I would watch on cable anytime it was on is probably going to be About Time. Because that...
It's a new favorite for you.
It's a new favorite. It's one I've had, you know, fairly short, but I just have this connection to that movie. I love that movie.
I just watched it for the first time last weekend, actually.
And I probably would watch it repeatedly, so that's going to be my
key. What did you think about it, Jake?
It was really good.
Yeah.
He said overrated.
It makes... What?
I never said overrated.
Yeah, he said Joel went a little crazy.
No.
The exact words.
It's a life-changing movie.
I don't know. I just making it up.
So About Time is going to be my cable. That's the one I would watch anytime it was on. Big Fish is going to have to be my IMAX because it is visually spectacular. And it's spectacle. Which means I'm going to have to erase It's a Wonderful
you
Life
want to erase
from existence.
It's a Wonderful Life from everyone's memory in
Without,
the world.
You ruined Christmas.
I know, right? Like,
I really did.
No angels are getting their wings now.
This wasn't easy. The thing
That's
is,
you terrible. Killed Jimmy
I'm
Stewart.
Not, I'm not going to see It's a Wonderful Life in IMAX.
Basically, you're a monster.
I am. I am, and I feel
I mean,
terrible about it.
Without It's a Wonderful Life, I dare say we would not have those other two movies.
We wouldn't even be good people without that movie.
Look, you can't get after me for my decision. It wasn't an easy decision. This is Sophie's choice.
I feel like you rushed to this decision.
I had to. The timer's timing and, you know.
Well, Jake, you'll be happy to know that It's a Wonderful Life, just like it is every single year, it's a cable movie for me. You could watch this movie again and again, and even if you're like, it's too long, or this whole Mr. Potter thing is just kind of, I don't really get it, and Mr. there's no resolution. Man, it's heartwarming every single time. It's a great story.
It is.
And I know it's a little bit too old for you. I know you don't old movies, Joel.
Oh, come on. Anyone
maybe
knows
the color, you wouldn't
Kent's
have
never seen
it.
A movie before 1980.
Hey, last year I started.
You did?
Yeah.
I love It's a Wonderful Life. It actually did not do well
you,
in its initial
You
running.
Erased it. In fact, humanity will never have known that it was made because of you.
Basically, what happened to George Bailey?
Except for me, I'll be watching it on cable.
What happened to George Bailey happened to the movie.
He never existed.
Never existed.
You're a bad person.
I'm so sorry.
About Time would be my IMAX movie, actually, because I prefer it over Big Fish. I think Big Fish is a very good movie.
About Time isn't visual, though. Like, Big Fish is spectacle.
Yeah, but if there's a movie that I would care to not have seen over Big Fish and About Time, Big Fish would just take a hike. Like, honestly, it's a good movie. And yeah. You're right, it is spectacle, but it's not as quality a movie.
No, the truth is,
it's About Time.
I feel it is the lesser quality of all three of these movies, but it's visually so entertaining and visually amazing. And in IMAX, it would be awesome.
I mean, it's not visually, like, crazy. Like, it's good visually.
It's good. It's really
It's Tim
good.
Burton, like, messing around with other color palettes,
it's Tim
which
Burton's
is nice.
Last good movie.
Yeah, it's true. But still, it's not even one of his greats. It's just a good Tim Burton movie.
Says you.
Says me.
We're going to have to do a Tim Burton podcast.
Oh, no. No.
Yes.
Can we wear black, like, black and white stripes?
We're going to be in goth.
And don't shower for, like, a week or two.
Yeah.
So, there we go.
Yeah.
We good there?
Yeah, we're good.
All right. I'm probably with you on that one, by the way, Kent.
Yeah.
Oh, psh.
You always pick me.
Big surprise.
Always pick Kent. All right, Kent. Are you ready for this?
Mm-hmm.
Punch in the gut.
Already?
He gave me one. That was one of yours, wasn't it?
It wasn't, actually.
That wasn't? That was one of you?
That was me.
Jacob, you sadist.
I know. No, that one only occurred to me like minutes ago, and I had some help with that one, too.
From whom?
Amy. I couldn't think of... anyway, It's a Wonderful Life was the one I couldn't think of. Threw that one in. I was like, okay. I was like, it has to be family movies.
He killed a classic. Yeah. Like, that's so shocking to me.
It is so shocking.
I know.
It's like, is there a more beloved movie on earth than that?
No.
I don't think so.
No.
No.
Shawshank?
There's a prison scene in there that I'm not quite sure matches.
My mom not on loves TBS. That one.
Yeah. Not on
TNT. TNT.
TNT, okay. Where it lives.
All right, Kent. Fight Club?
Oh, my gosh. Already? Seriously?
His favorite movie.
Inception?
Stop it!
Man of Steel. And this one is from Joel.
He actually made this kind of easy, because while I really, really enjoy Man of Steel, it would be erased from existence. I mean, it's quite easy here.
I think that's something we can all agree on.
Every show. Inception or Fight Club? Wow. Actually, this is easy.
Well, if you've erased Man of Steel, it doesn't really matter.
And this is going to go against my logic. And, Joel, I know you're going to fight with my logic. My logic in this game is like your logic with rating movies. It's all over the place.
Come on.
But it doesn't belong in your face if it's not all over the place.
It's a simple 5-star rating system, Kent. What's so hard about that?
With descriptions on every single one. Man of Steel is being erased. Fight Club is my cable movie. Fight Club I have seen probably 23 times.
You know the exact number?
And you say probably with the exact number?
23? Unsurprising.
It'll be 24 starting tonight. But Inception would be my IMAX movie.
Okay.
I just think Fight Club is kind of meant to be have this gritty look. And if I see it on like a TV standard definition, that's fine. Mm-hmm. Because it's not totally emphasized for HD. Inception, everything about it is just art. And so that's my IMAX movie. And I would see it a lot in IMAX. But yeah. There you go.
There you go.
All right.
For me, I'm going to say, this is fairly easy as well, Inception is my cable movie. I love watching that one.
How many times have you seen Inception?
Twice.
Yeah.
But I definitely could watch it again.
Big fan.
I enjoy it. Man of Steel is going to be my IMAX. And I'm erasing Fight Club from existence.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, I knew this about you. I'm always surprised when you don't have the Fight Club love.
I don't know what it is. I never got into the Fight Club fandom.
I think it's you were always like a really nice kid.
Shut up.
I think naive is the wrong word. But I'm going to use it anyways.
I don't really get the love for Fight Club. I appreciate it for what it is. It's good filmmaking, but I really did not relate to anyone there. And so I don't relate to the characters. I don't really relate to the story. And personally, I mean, like I said, I like Man of Steel. I don't like Fight Club.
At all?
No, it's a 2-star.
What is a 2-star meaning?
That's all you need to know. It's a simple 2-star rating system.
Out of what? 17.2?
Out of 5, just like Netflix and Flixster and all those other movie places. It's a 5-star, simple
5-star. That means didn't like it.
I didn't like it.
If you're going Netflix, it's didn't like it.
Didn't like it.
Wow. It's always hurtful because listener.
But I know that's your favorite movie, and my brothers like it too, but I just never been a fan.
Is the content too dark? Because it is a very graphic movie.
It's very dark.
And
it's
very
nihilistic.
Yeah, that's true.
And anarchistic.
But you got to realize it spoke to a generation of which is a little bit beyond me, but the Gen Xers who were just tired of being the average white guy, basically, fighting against a system.
So then they're a buff white guy? Tyler Durden is not that different from the narrator.
True. But it's a Fight Club to get out frustration. It wasn't all about fighting, as you well know, unless you missed the point of the movie, which you may have.
It was just about fighting, right?
Which is what was crazy. This movie came out, and everyone's like, oh, a Brad Pitt movie. The guy who's in Meet Joe Black and all that. Thelma and Louise. This guy was a sex symbol. And then they're like, he's in a movie about fighting. And then it wasn't about fighting at all. It was this brain twister that kind of changed the game in terms of psychological thrillers.
And I appreciate its influence on cinema. It just never was for me. And
that's surprising to me.
And I think that people that like it, they do relate to it, and that's fine.
I've never even watched it all the way through. I always fall asleep.
But I'm sorry.
What?
He has narcolepsy.
Okay, because I was going to say
he has insomnia.
He hates good dialogue monologues.
He can't tell when he's awake and when he's asleep.
Are you asleep right now?
What?
Yeah. Okay.
So.
Okay. All right. So that's hurtful, but you know,
all right, Joel.
It is what it is.
All right.
Joel's turn.
I'm ready.
Nightmare on Elm Street, Halloween, The Ring.
Ooh. Nightmare on Elm Street, Halloween, and The Ring. And going into this, I don't know if it's been brought up before on this podcast, but I am a big fan of Halloween and horror movies. I'm a big fan. Wow. That's going to be tough. Because the thing about it is Halloween is really good. Like, for what it did, but it's been copied so many times since that you go back and watch it, and it almost seems lesser. Nightmare on Elm Street is a new kind of killer he plays with his victims. It's campy. It's fun. But then The Ring, that one terrifies me. I remember the first time I saw it, it messed with my head.
Well, you kind of have to think, which horror movie would you want to see in the theater? Because remember, the theater is a very good chance to see something where a bunch of people around you are going to scream and get scared at the same time.
Right.
And so there's that mob mentality. Which of these movies would you be most affected by?
Right. I'm going to have to say, though, that Nightmare on Elm Street is going to be my cable. Because I used to watch it on cable all the time. I used to wait and see when it was coming on USA and watch it. It's actually where I saw most of the Nightmare on Elm Street was on the USA Network. The Ring is going to have to be my IMAX because visually it's horrifying. And seeing it in the theater. I didn't see Halloween or Nightmare on Elm Street in the theaters. I saw The Ring in theaters and the reaction from the audience was electric. I loved it. I'm going to have to erase Halloween from existence. As much as it did for the horror film genre.
I can actually understand. I mean, because there's tons like it now.
Yeah.
So you don't even lose Halloween.
It spawned the slasher genre, which...
Oh, wait. No, but then it never existed.
Yeah,
that's
true. Yeah, it's from existence. So we lose all
Eli
the slasher
Roth would have
movies.
Stepped up anyway.
Yeah.
But that's a Carpenter classic right
now.
I know.
In honor of Wes Craven, I'm not going to get rid of Nightmare on Elm Street.
Okay. I mean, even though I love Halloween and I disagree with Joel, I think it still stands up.
It's fine.
I'll watch it, you know, maybe every 2 years in October, and just seeing Michael Myers standing there in the daylight, mm-hmm. I'm like, what the crap? This is so scary.
That's the good thing about this. You make a very good point that daytime scares don't happen that often in horror movies.
No.
So Halloween did that, and it was fantastic. The Ring actually also does it mm-hmm. in the final scene, and I love it when they're able to do that, when they're able to kind of kick against the genre and try something different.
That said, even though I love it, Halloween is being erased, and I hate to say it.
Wow.
Because I love all three of these movies.
You're not giving Jamie Lee Curtis her breakout role.
Yeah, I know. Dang it.
We'll never have her either.
You just got rid of Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yeah. Now there's no True Lies.
We got rid of Jamie Lee Curtis. All
right? No, it's on you right now. We didn't bring that up when I was talking about
it. And much like you, I grew up watching Nightmare on Elm Street and its subsequent sequels. It was kind of weird, but these movies were like my Disney movies. I watched them every day when I recorded them off TV.
Yep.
And I was like, Dream Warriors every single day.
In my dreams, I'm beautiful. She's like this 80s punk rocker.
It's so good. And the guy in the wheelchair, the wizard. Oh,
yes.
Man.
Oh, what does he keep screaming?
Oh, what does he scream?
I'm the wizard of something, something. I'm the magician of something, something. I don't remember.
Dang it. There's someone yelling at the podcast right now, which is okay.
Yeah.
Yell at us at, you know, Baconsale, Twitter, you know, whatever. In The Ring, I think it is the lesser movie of these three.
What?
No, I think so.
It revitalized the horror genre in the early 2000s.
It's true, but then it quickly died. Like, as fast as, like, the J-horror thing started, it went down just as quick.
Yeah.
I am the wizard master.
That's it.
Yeah.
But seeing The Ring in the theater, and when Samara jumps out of the, you know, she walks out of the TV, jumps out of the sky... I remember the crowd just going, oh,
walks out
and
of the
jumping
TV,
back.
Jumps out of the sky?
No, jumps out at the guy.
What movie were you watching? Samara skydiving?
That's a sequel?
Oh, the sequel is
it's
so
Japanese
bad.
Only. I'm a hipster
it's
like that.
It's so bad. Oh, Ringu. Ringu's not that good either.
No.
The original Japanese one it was based
on. I mean, it's okay for what it is, but...
It's really not. I thought Ju-on, the Grudge, the original Japanese Grudge was better than Ringu.
Yes. But seeing The Ring in the theater was quite an experience, and it was just tension and fear... And I think the pacing was kind of great. Even though I do think it's a lesser movie, still has the scares that I want to see on the big screen.
Yeah.
So I agree.
And I don't know if I should tell this story or not, but I went to go see it in the theaters with like my uncles and my cousins. Like, it was this big event. All of us went to go see The Ring.
Yeah.
And I arranged for a friend of mine to call I gave them all their phone numbers. And after it was over, they looked at their phones and there were messages on all their phones. And I had them do like *67, I think it is, to do it unlisted.
Oh, yeah.
And they just had this voicemail of a little voice going, 7 days.
That's awesome.
On all their phones. And I had them do it to me, too, so I could be like, we all got it. And I don't think to this day, until right now, I've admitted to that, like, in public.
I remember seeing this movie and then going, I think I was home for the weekend. I went back to college. And remember, I'm like 21, 22. And I was like, oh, my gosh, I saw the scariest movie over the weekend, The Ring. It's so awesome. I'm raving about it. Some other guy walks in. He's pretty dopey. And he's like, guys, I have to warn you. I just saw the most satanic movie of all time.
I had a roommate that did that,
yeah,
too.
And he goes, it's The Ring. No, please, no one ever see it. It is satanic. You know, protect your soul. And I'm sitting there like, the evil guy in the corner that was just raving about the devil movie. I'm like, ugh. But basically I was like, you're a moron.
No, I had a friend of mine, a roommate of mine, a good friend, and he said the same thing. He's like, it's satanic. And I said, how is it satanic? He's like, it's got a fly in it. And I was like, what? And
then he explained, flies are, I hate them, but
Beelzebub apparently means the Lord of the Flies, and the fly is a symbol of Satan. And there's the fly.
Are
in the movie.
You kidding me?
It was a stretch. And when he said that, I was like, I'm not buying this. I am buying The Ring though on DVD.
Okay.
I feel like I'm getting excited for our Halloween podcast.
I know.
Now.
Yep. Here, October is soon. Okay. All right. This one is, well, it's really to, actually the next two are really for both of you.
This is
okay.
Kent first though, right?
Yeah. Kent first. Rudy. Mighty Ducks.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the Titans. I would erase all three.
Oh, why?
I am like anti-inspirational sports dramas.
All of them though?
I'm going to pick. No, not, yeah, I love Rocky.
Okay.
We know this. Rocky IV, especially.
Okay.
So, Rudy the Mighty Ducks and Remember the Titans.
Yep.
I would erase Remember the Titans.
But you're supposed to remember them.
Well, there goes my joke.
Yeah. It is as cliche as you can get. It is kind of heartwarming, but it's just like chicken soup for the soul. And that's about all
the
value it has.
Chicken soup for the story, though.
Kind of. Not really. Have you gone and looked at the real true story? The real story?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it. No.
Yeah. Well, there you go. It's not. I'll just say it's not. That's my true story. I would erase that movie.
Okay.
People rave about it and they, whatever. I just think it basically created about 5 to 6 years of sports movie clones that were the same thing. And it, you know, I didn't dig it at all. But then I have Rudy and the Mighty Ducks.
Yeah.
And listen, Rudy is the clear, like one of the greats.
Yeah.
It is the great.
Is it the great?
It's the great.
What's your favorite sports movie, Kent?
I don't even know if I have one.
If it's a genre that you hate.
Rocky?
Like
quite literally Rocky. I like Cinderella Man quite a bit.
Warrior or Karate Kid.
You know, okay, Karate Kid's great. Warrior, I think, is a kitchen sink movie, and we can get there.
The Fighter, Moneyball. I'm just looking at
it. No, I hate Moneyball. But that's another show altogether.
Yeah, let's hear it.
Okay, so, oh, man. This is so stupid. Rudy's My Cable. Yeah. I think Rudy's My Cable movie. Because, yes, I have seen that on cable and enjoyed it every time.
So you want to see Mighty Ducks on the IMAX?
Yeah. I want to see Goldberg up there.
I am Goldberg. The goalie.
I want to see Pacey on the Mighty Ducks.
You want to see Emilio Estevez?
And Emilio Estevez. The movie is, it's kind of fun. And, you know, when I saw it in the theaters, I was like, yeah, this is pretty cool. I guess I care about hockey for 2 days. And that's it. So, yeah.
There you go.
All right, Joel.
I'm actually going to echo his, truthfully, because I thought about it and I was like, you know, remember the Titans? We could erase that from existence, and we have so many other sports movies that are exactly the same. So, sorry, Denzel. Nothing happened in there. Although, I may flip it. I may say Mighty Ducks is my cable one.
Okay, because it's easy.
Well, that one I can watch my own, no problem. But, like, Rudy, I remember I watched that one in the theaters,
mm-hmm.
and it was one of those movies where you hear the guy next to you kind of sniffling. It's like, you crying? No, I'm not.
So you want to see this in IMAX where there's a big sweeping score.
Yes.
And just kind of be
so
taken away.
See the stadium and just go, this is the most beautiful sight these eyes have ever seen.
Also, the true story is quite different than the actual movie.
Well.
Why you got to be ruining all this?
Because I hate the genre. I hate it.
There's some good ones in there.
Where? Like,
I don't know if you knew this, Kent, but Rocky IV never even happened, like in any way. It's not even a true story at all.
No, but Kent and I both have a pet
You're
peeve.
You're a jerk, first off.
Kent and I both have a pet peeve that if it says based on a true story and it goes completely off the rails, it's like, that's not based on a true story.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm going to agree with him. We can move on.
All right.
And Jake, feel free to jump in if you have like some like crazy difference of opinion.
He'll throw in the plot twist at the end and add 20 minutes. So.
Yeah.
Still mad about that, huh?
A little bit.
You're the one that wasted all the time in the front. All right. Okay, I'm going to throw back in a movie we've used before. So
what? Already?
Forgive me. Yeah, unfortunately. Matrix, Inception, Terminator 2.
Oh.
All right, Joel's first.
I'm going to have to say that The Matrix is going to be my cable. I'm always up for watching The Matrix. Every time it's on, I'm like, yes, this is a fun movie to watch. And I appreciate what a great movie it is. Inception is going to be my IMAX for spectacle reasons and because it is a mind bender. And I'm going to have to get rid of Terminator 2.
Is it? This seems kind of easy for you. Was it that easy?
No, because I love because Terminator 2.
Did you see The Matrix in the theater?
No, I was gone.
Oh, okay. Oh. That was in your, you know.
That was when
dark I went ages.
I went on my mission, Kent.
Yeah. There you go. Because Matrix in the theater was awesome.
It was.
I saw that. That was the first movie since Jurassic Park, which was 6 years previous, that I saw like seven times in the theater. Because it was that much fun.
Well,
I think I did it three times.
Yeah. It's difficult, though, because I used to watch Terminator 2 constantly, all the time we watched that movie. That was when we could quote me and my brothers off the top of our heads. But
your brothers are going to be so mad at you.
They will. If we don't have Terminator 2, then we don't get Terminator 2, 3 or Terminator Salvation or Terminator Genesis or the Terminator series. I don't think it would spawn any of those. And it would have just been a horror movie from the early 80s, the Terminator.
I want to agree with Joel because, honestly, Inception is a big screen experience. And Matrix I have seen countless times since it came out.
Mm-hmm.
But Matrix in the theater was incredible. It was so much fun. And just the bullet shells hitting the walls.
Can I tell you something about The Matrix? So I didn't see it.
It wasn't a true story.
I was actually...
It actually was.
I was in the Mission Training Center, and I had another missionary there try to explain The Matrix to me.
Mm-hmm.
It did not make sense.
But did it interest you?
Oh, it did. Yeah, he was like, then he's fast, but then he's not fast. Because he's looking from the other side, and he's going slow. And I was like, I have no idea what you're talking about right now. But it did intrigue me, and I did enjoy it when I got home.
Yeah. I would erase Terminator 2.
Terminator 2, too.
Yeah, I would kill Skynet and erase Terminator 2 from existence
just to protect us.
It's one of the few genres where the sequel is possibly better than the original.
Definitely better.
Yeah.
Possibly.
No way.
Because the Terminator is a very good horror movie. This is an action movie. It's a completely different genre.
And it's kind of tough because Terminator 2 is like infinitely watchable on cable. Probably more than Inception, but there's no way I'm going to kill Inception and erase Inception.
Maybe I would.
Over Terminator 2. You probably would. Like, you've seen T2 way more than Inception.
That's true.
I think you should take a side.
Yeah, it's true. Inception is not really rewatchable.
Are you kidding me?
What?
No, I mean, like, cable-wise. Like, I wouldn't want it just be on all the time. I think it's an incredible
movie. I'm changing my vote.
I disagree.
I'm erasing Inception from existence, and I'm turning Terminator 2 into my cable, and then Matrix into my IMAX.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Also, anyone getting mad at us at home right now, you try and do this, okay? It's not easy. It's hard to choose which one you're going to get rid of.
But let the record show that Joel likes Terminator 2 more than Inception.
That's probably
good to know.
Fair statement.
Is it really?
Probably.
Wow. Shame on you.
I've seen Terminator 2 more times, and I still enjoy it.
Yeah, it came out in 1991. Of course you've seen it more times.
It's a lot of staying power.
It's true.
All right.
I mean, I am with Joel that really, like, it actually has kind of a black eye just from how many stupid movies have come after it. Or lackluster movies, rather.
Terminator 2, you mean?
Yeah, since Terminator 2, you know. But it's still, that's a...
Well, in Matrix, to a different extent.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Wouldn't even bring that up, did we?
No. There's only one Matrix movie.
It's like the rest don't even exist.
Wait, they made a sequel?
Next up.
This is Kent, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Spider-Man 3. Batman and Robin. X-Men First Class. Or no, X-Men Last Stand, sorry.
Oh, okay. I was going to like, that's easy. Oh, this is terrible.
This is from my mind.
Yeah, this
of course
control.
It is. It's disturbing. Spider-Man 3, the Tobey Maguire goes emo, Topher Grace that keeps taking off his Venom mask.
Got
movie.
Quite a nice dance scene in that, though, right? I mean, right.
No.
What?
If you weren't so far across the table, I'd punch you in the face.
Batman and Robin, or Batman never leaves home without his Batman Forever credit card. And
so
as we all know, and I'm sorry, Joel,
so
but
stupid.
Bat nipples on the suit. Oh, and Mr. Freeze, I still see you.
Don't forget Poison Ivy.
Oh.
One of the few times I've actually found him with him attractive, though, was in that movie.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. And X-Men 3.
Yeah, these are...
X-Men 3 is looking pretty good right now. Like, I hate that movie.
Way to go, Brett Ratner.
And, like, I hate that movie for what it did to X-Men 2, because X-Men 2 ended with such potential that you were excited for the future. And then when Brett Ratner said, here you go, here's 90 mutants on screen, it was a disaster. And they killed important characters. They ruined the Phoenix storyline that we discussed.
Scott!
Oh, my goodness. This is so difficult.
Yeah, let's hear it.
It's for the different reasons in the last couple, though.
Yeah.
But I'm making a stand. Batman and Robin is destroyed. It is eliminated from any memory. I know it has camp value and it would be kind of fun to watch like a midnight movie sort of thing. But if it was the first time I'd seen it, just like it was back in the day, it's an atrocious movie, and it would be erased. Oh, mercy. Now what? I hate this. X-Men 3 would be my cable movie.
Wow.
Because I feel like...
You're getting into a long-term relationship with X-Men 3.
Yeah, I feel like I could dull my brain and just be like, okay, all right, yeah, I can watch this. And, oh, okay, that was dumb, but whatever. Whereas Spider-Man 3, it is still a big screen experience. I really do like the Sandman. I think he's a cool villain. It was everything was wrong about it, but still it was cool to see on the big screen.
Yeah.
I have an affinity towards Sam Raimi and Spider-Man. I think he handled him well. I think Sony got very involved in Spider-Man 3 and ruined it. And the Venom thing was just a disaster.
I thought Topher Grace did fine. I thought they were just... They gave him a crap to work with.
Okay, yeah. I mean, that's fair. But
because
yeah.
as the rival photographer, I actually was really into that story.
Yeah.
And then when he became Venom with the half face, when his mask was off, mm-hmm. and it was like half him, I was like, I'm not buying
it. And the James Franco turn.
No.
Like, they built it up so much, and it was so good leading up to then, even though Franco's not a great actor. And then it was ruined. He put on some ski mask, and I didn't get his intentions at all.
No. Yeah.
So it's a disaster of a movie, and people say it's the worst. In a world where we have Batman and Robin and Fantastic Four, but yeah. It's my IMAX movie.
That's your Spider-Man 3 is your IMAX?
Yeah.
Movie? Okay.
All right, Joel?
Well, I'm going to say Batman and Robin is my cable. I have watched Batman and Robin more times than I'd care to admit.
And
well,
more times why? Than
well,
for
I
sure.
acknowledge it is.
Yeah, what's a,
yes, you, and you, that is true. But it's because.
Please send your hate mail.
I was like a 16-year-old boy working at Quiznos when this movie came out. And the video store next door had swag, so I had like a Batman and Robin hat and a Batman and Robin poster and stuff like that.
So you were bought out?
A little bit. But I, as much as horrible and campy as it is, I still find some juvenile enjoyment in it, and so I'm going to say that's my cable.
What do you enjoy from that movie? What's your takeaway from Batman and Robin?
I like the soundtrack.
Okay, the soundtrack?
Smashing Pumpkins.
Yeah, that's true.
They had the beginning is the end is the beginning before Watchmen did.
Yeah.
I enjoy certain parts of it, and it's stupid, and I know that, but I enjoy certain parts of it. Spider-Man 3 is going to be my IMAX.
Okay.
Because there are parts of it that are redeemable.
Mm-hmm.
Even though the emo part, I'll just shut my eyes during that part. I'm going to erase X-Men The Last Stand from the past, because that's what Days of Future Past
did. Yeah.
Bryan Singer already erased Last Stand.
Well played.
So I'm not doing any wrong by getting rid of that movie.
That's true.
It actually doesn't exist at this point. You're right.
Yeah, it's already got a precedent.
Days of Future Past is basically saying, all right, Last Stand didn't happen, everybody. We reset. Ready? Here we go. So there you go.
Yeah, that was a good move. Yeah. Okay.
That was tough.
All right, that was a fun one. That was a fun one.
It's so ridiculous.
I love how we're like actually making these official decisions.
Yeah.
Like we sit on some board, we're like, this movie will never have been created in the first place.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like the media deity
board. We
would
have never known how to defeat the Phoenix if it wasn't for Last Stand.
Yeah.
Now it doesn't even matter.
Nope.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Scott.
Joel, you're going to lead this one.
Okay.
Master of Disguise.
Oh, God.
It's Pat.
No.
Little Nicky.
Oh.
You're welcome.
This is from Kent.
Oh.
I'm not answering this, by the way. I'm not taking part.
No, you have to.
You definitely have to. The double-edged sword.
So excited for this.
I'm going to erase Master of Disguise from existence.
Over It's Pat?
I cannot
That's
stand.
His IMAX.
I cannot stand Master of Turtle. Disguise.
Turtle.
Oh, just thinking about the movie gets me
Give
so
us
mad.
A background of these movies just
yeah,
in case people
yeah,
don't
most
know.
Most people don't even know what
A Master
are.
Of Disguise is Dana Carvey's attempt at his old-style humor in a modern world. And while I do like Dana Carvey as a comedian, I think he has a lot of talent. This movie did not.
It's kind of like The Man Who Knew Too Little with impressions.
No, The Man Who Knew Too Little was better than this
movie. No, obviously, but I'm saying that kind of spin on the spy genre.
Kind of. Except for he has magical powers, but he doesn't. It's sad when the only thing that's funny in your movie is flatulence jokes, and that is literally the only thing I laughed at was the villain who every time he'd do his evil laugh, he would at the end of it.
And you laughed at that?
I laughed, and I was like, oh, God, I can't. Because I was starving for humor. I'm going to say that It's Pat is my cable.
What's It's Pat about?
It's based on the Saturday Night Live character, the androgynous Pat. You don't know if it's a boy or a girl. It's a harmless it's a harmless skit from Saturday Night Live, and I'm going to have to go with Little Nicky then as my IMAX, which saddens. That saddens me.
That's disgusting.
A movie about the devil's nephew or something like that, is it?
Yeah. And yeah. It's Adam Sandler.
It is.
And, like, and he was actually on a roll at this point. I mean, his career, I mean, actually up until now he's been doing great, but people loved him. I mean, even The Waterboy, which I thought was pretty awful, had just come out, and then he made Little Nicky. Big Daddy was right around this time, too. Little Nicky was a huge disappointment.
So what are you saying?
I'm not playing. No, I'm out for the rest
of
the game.
No, just do it real quick.
It's Pat is being erased because it basically has been erased from everyone's everyone's memory.
I don't know about that. I kind of like it.
It's so awkward. my cable movie is probably Little Nicky. It is so annoying. His voice is the worst, but it's a movie that I could just...
Can you do his voice?
No, I'm not even going to try. That's kind of your job. But, yeah, it's a movie that I would look forward to the commercials when it was playing on cable.
Oh, thank goodness. L'Oreal.
I hope there's more terms and conditions of this medication. Please, keep reading. And then Master of Disguise would be my IMAX movie.
You're sick. You're sick.
I actually saw this one in the theater.
Turtle.
I saw it at the Provo Dollar Theater for 50 cents. And it was worth every penny.
No, it's not.
It was
literally
so,
50 pennies.
So bad.
The worst movies in the world are comedies. You can laugh at a bad drama.
Yeah.
You can't laugh at a bad comedy.
But no, it was awful. But yeah, it's probably my big screen experience.
Wow. All right, there we go. Let's move off this with these ones. It's making me sick.
Yeah. Next round up. Let's do Jaws, Jurassic Park, Indiana Jones.
Oh, which Indiana Jones?
The first one.
So Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Not Indiana Jones.
Well,
so Spielberg is what we're talking about.
Spielberg is the theme.
So I'm going first. Oh, man. Jaws, Jurassic Park, Indiana Jones, and so Raiders of the Lost Ark. This is impossible. This is truly impossible.
This is a cruel one, to be sure.
Is Ken going first?
I'm going first. Yep. So it gives you more time to prepare. I never saw Jaws in theater. I mean, it came out in 1975, and I wasn't born. I would love to have seen it in the theater. Because, wow, it did.
I would love to see it on a tube in a swimming pool or in the ocean.
No way.
That would be great.
They actually do screenings at some pools, public pools, where they'll put Jaws on a big screen and have everyone float on a tube and watch it.
I got to make a snap judgment. I can't spend too long on this or I'm going to feel too guilty. I'm killing Jurassic Park.
Whoa!
I'm so sorry. I'm erasing Jurassic Park.
Why do you hate America?
No, it's not that I do. I hate Isla Nublar.
Dinosaurs.
I love dinosaurs. Oh, my gosh. I'm betraying my inner child. Yes, I loved dinosaurs. Oh, who doesn't? But, I got to do this. I got to make the decision. I hate you for doing this. Why is this so stressful? We're talking about three random movies.
And it's not even going to have
random.
There's no real effect to this.
But I feel like there is. I feel like I have to give away my Blu-ray copy of Jurassic Park now.
You kind
of
do, actually. Do you own all three of these on Blu-ray?
There's only one Jurassic Park.
No. Not all three.
All
Jurassic
three of the movies.
Park.
Oh, do Jaws, I own all three Jurassic of these? Park and I Indiana. Own Raiders on DVD and the rest on Blu-ray.
Oh.
So maybe I'm not as big a fan. No, Raiders of the Lost Ark is so much fun. And that is the movie that is instantly rewatchable. That's the movie I would be married to. I would just take it.
You'd watch it on cable, you mean?
Yes.
That's what it means. That's what it means.
Yes, Joel. That is the movie that I watch on cable repeatedly and have. It's so much fun. You could pick up at any point and know exactly where you are and just go along for the ride. Jurassic Park, I feel like it would get really, really... I mean, okay. This, from a person who's seen it maybe 18 times, I think it would get old.
I like how he, like, maybe this specific number.
Maybe 73 times I've watched this. I don't know for sure.
42.
I mean, it's no Fight Club or Matrix.
42.3 times. I actually fell asleep during one of them.
I'm not Jake.
No.
Yeah, this isn't Fight Club.
But Indiana Raiders of the Lost Ark is my cable watch. And Jaws, I want to see this in the theater for the first time. Like, I want to be there in the first crowd seeing this movie and just feeling that fear. I would love that. That is my dream. Right. Joel, please go. I can't think about this anymore.
I have thought about it. Raiders of the Lost Ark is going to be my cable show because we watched that one ad nauseum as kids. We loved watching that one, and the face-melting scene is fantastic. It does get a little slow in the middle there until the monkey dies from the bad dates.
Yeah,
but it's a good movie. I can watch that one again and again and again. I'm going to give Jurassic Park the IMAX.
Oh.
Because I saw that in theaters. Our science class, our science teachers in our junior high rented out a theater and took us all there.
Well, that's cool.
We all got to go see it together. And that theater experience, seeing those dinosaurs for the first time.
Oh, it's amazing.
Was spectacular. On the big screen, these huge dinosaurs and then the raptors and then the triceratops. Fantastic. I'm going to get rid of Jaws. It's erased from existence because then maybe I wouldn't be so scared of water where I can't see the bottom. I'm not wondering what's below me.
Swimming pools. I go to Bear Lake, which is a freshwater lake, and I'm afraid a shark is going to get me. I'm not even kidding you.
I do the same thing where it's like if I can't see the bottom of the water, I get nervous because I'm like, Jaws is down
there.
See,
but it's two different experiences. Like Jurassic Park, it is so much fun. And when I saw it, I was, you know, 12, 13. You were about the same age.
Yes.
And it was fun. You're like, oh, this is magic happening on screen. But Jaws was the instant fear.
Oh, it gets you deep down inside. And that's why it's going.
Especially,
I'm not scared of the water anymore.
Basically, Pitt's saying that he loves horror more than you do.
Yeah.
I'm just scared of Deep Blue Sea and Piranha now, so.
That's what's really affected you. Piranha 3 Double D.
Oh, God.
Yeah. It's affected Kent. You can change his Twitter handle. Yeah.
Love it.
It has.
All right.
That was the worst one. I hated that.
Yeah, that was
Piranha 3 Double D.
No, that was okay, actually.
Oh, okay.
That category.
Oh, that category. Oh, the dumb ones were really bothering me.
All right. Then you'll love this one. Diary of a Mad Black Woman.
No! Why? I didn't do your worst ones. I didn't do Spring Breakers in any
of
these.
You didn't? I am shocked that you didn't.
I couldn't pair it with anything else. Diary of a Mad Black Woman is my worst hated movie, everyone.
Now and Then.
Oh, come on! You went on my website, you went on my blog, didn't you?
You posted it. There's a paper trail, man.
Come on.
The Divine Secrets of the Ya-Ya Sisterhood.
Oh, I knew that was coming.
Cable, IMAX, erased.
So there's a very feminine theme here. Diary of a Mad Black Woman, and then
Sisterhood. If you go to the former 786.blogspot.com, my blog.
Yes, which I did last night.
Yeah, I have a section where it's my least favorite movies of all time, and actually Master of Disguise is on there as well.
It's number 10.
I can't believe I was going to do Spring Breakers, but I couldn't think of any other ones you really hated as much as Spring Breakers. So you've got me on this one.
Yeah.
You know what? I'm going to erase Diary of a Mad Black Woman from existence because that will make me happy.
This is actually a favorite of you, just to give you that opportunity.
That one.
Mentally.
Tyler Perry now has no career.
Oh, God. I'm going to say Now and Then is going to be my cable, because it'll be on.
So you're going to see.
And that'll make Devon Sawa's in it, and that'll make my wife really happy. So there.
A child of Devon Sawa makes your wife happy.
She had a huge crush on him back in the day. Apparently that in Casper. I don't even know who he is. And then Divine Secrets of the Ya-Ya Sisterhood, it's going to be my IMAX.
It's such a great movie to see in IMAX.
And I'll enjoy it because the reason I watched it is because of Ashley Judd and Sandra Bullock. But I am not the market for any of these movies. I will fully admit that, but those are terrible.
But I thought
How
it was strange.
Dare you, sir? How dare you?
I thought it was strange.
I'm getting you next time.
You just did the bro thing that you wanted to throw down.
No, I should have done the Spring Breakers one.
Yeah, I talk bad about enough movies. I'm surprised you didn't use more.
I can't think of any other that you hated as much, though.
Yeah, but still, maybe there's a different kind of theater experience or cable, you know, that could have beat it.
Oh, that's what I should have done. I'll say that for next time.
Okay. Yeah, because...
Should there be a next time?
This may... If you, listener, like it, maybe we'll do this again.
Yeah, if you, one listener, like it.
Yeah. Oh, man. I have to agree with you 100%. I really like Christina Ricci. And so I could watch her on Now and Then on cable again and again. She was my childhood crush, which maybe says a little bit about me. I really liked her. And probably still do. Christina. Ashley Judd was my cougar crush. Like, it has been for a long time. I would like to see her up on IMAX. Joel? No. That wasn't bad, right?
I just was coughing.
Okay.
Me too.
And Diary of a Mad Black Woman would be erased. I totally agree. Oh. It's just super strange. I don't get the genre, but, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah.
So, yay.
There we go.
High five.
Yay.
I think we agreed on another one, but I don't want to high five Diary of a Mad Black Woman ever again. Unless it's, hey, Diary of a Mad Black Woman, erased from existence.
Yay. All right, Kent. The pendulum swings both ways. Are you ready for this?
Come on.
Oh, did you do one?
What?
Oh, this is mine?
No, this is for Kent.
Right.
Yeah. I don't even know what's happening. Are you guys okay? Do you guys want to continue the show?
I had a stroke. We're okay.
We're going to the next one. Monsters, Inc.
Oh, I knew it.
Oh, yeah.
Toy Story. Finding Nemo.
I mean, these actually aren't the worst choices, to be honest.
But you generally don't like Pixar.
You could have picked worse Pixar movies.
I could have.
Because Finding Nemo is easily being destroyed. Erased from existence.
Easily.
Finding Nemo is easily the worst of those three. Everyone likes it because it's fun and there's so many jokes. Oh, the voices are great. It's a pointless movie. And I'm sorry, I've never liked it. I've never really got into it. Whereas Monsters, Inc. and Toy Story, there are actual emotions in the movie.
Hmm. Man, people are going to be mad at you.
I'm just letting him hang himself.
Here. I know. It's like just like
here's
the silence.
Keep going with the rope. Here's the rope.
It's Finding Nemo stupid. It really is stupid.
It's not enough.
Like everyone is like, oh, Pixar is so great. Oh, great. They teach like basic morality tells with animation. That's so smart.
So what do you tell your daughter when she's like, I want to watch Finding Nemo? You're like, no, it's stupid.
No, like my daughter now is like, hey, for Halloween, this is going to sound like I'm ragging on her. Nope, I'm not going here.
No, you got to get started it now.
She's like, for Halloween, I want to be Joy from Inside Out. And I'm like, I took you to that movie twice, and you hated it both times. And just because you like the toy, you want to be that for Halloween?
This is what he said to her. Your actual words.
Yeah.
Hashtag
then
he's
like, Finding Nemo stupid, Inside Out is stupid. And I'm not impressed with you right now.
Does Joan,
Sophie's choice.
Does your wife listen to the podcast?
No, hopefully not. Monsters, Inc. and Toy Story. I think Toy Story is my cable movie. It's fun. It is kind of like, it is the roots of Pixar. And it's, man, I don't like either movie. I think I like Monsters, Inc. more than Toy Story.
Okay.
Because there is more emotion. I think the animation is far better. Obviously, they've grown leaps and bounds.
Yeah, Joel is brave and
Joel's doing Mr.
Too.
Burns right now because he's
this
glad
is going
that I'm
exactly according as I planned it.
You know, scratch that.
I would get my brothers back on my side.
I would rather watch Monsters, Inc. Repeatedly. And so that would be my cable movie. Toy Story would be my IMAX. So I did a little flip there.
Right at the end.
But Nemo is destroyed. Like, who cares? I'll take that rope.
But it's Australia. You love Australia.
Oh, they mentioned Australia. That's cool.
I'm going to go. Actually, I'm going to erase Finding Nemo as well.
Why?
That movie.
Because you gave me, you know, so much about it.
What?
Why?
I didn't give you so much about it. He gave you so much.
You were
about
excited
it.
That I was hating on it so much.
Because.
Yeah, and now you're erasing it too.
I have to erase one of these.
Yeah, but
Finding Nemo.
Jake doesn't even know what to say.
You betrayed him. I'm totally shocked right now.
I'm not going to erase either one of the other ones. Finding Nemo, to me, it was much too stressful, I'll say that. That it just seemed like, it was like Meet the Parents, where it was just like bad thing after bad thing after bad thing, and I was like, give me something good.
Pretty lazy writing, right? But since it's animation, isn't it great?
It's good writing.
Look what they did!
It's a good movie, but I'm going to have to erase that one from existence. I'm going to say Toy Story is going to be my go-to watching on cable.
Okay.
I can always watch Toy Story, always happy to. It's a fun story, I enjoy it. And I'm going to say Monsters, Inc. is going to be my IMAX simply because it is more about spectacle. And in particular, like the giant snowball scene and stuff like that, where it's like, that'll look much cooler in IMAX.
Well, Jake, do you have an opinion? Because it seems like you do.
No, not really.
About anything? Come on.
Should we do one more?
Let's do two more.
Two more?
One or two more.
Two more. All right, Joel, we're going to do another director theme.
All right.
All right.
You didn't do any of my other themes.
Do you want one of the ones you had for Kent?
No.
All right. Psycho?
Oh, no.
Rear Window.
Oh, no.
Vertigo.
Darn it. I thought one would be Marnie. Yeah.
For those who don't know, there is a rivalry between the Alfred Hitchcock movie Marnie.
Yes.
And these two disagree quite a bit. That may actually be a show where I host.
It's Jacob's favorite movie. And
I host and you guys fight about it.
Only trolling me right now.
Jacob's named his three children all Marnie.
The movie has value, and Joel insists the movie has zero value.
Save it for the show. Save it for the show.
All right. So Psycho, Rear Window, and Vertigo.
That's it.
Okay, this is difficult. Because I like all these movies. I'm going to have to say...
I think you and I will agree on this. I'm just predicting.
I just think that I'm going to have Rear Window be my cable. No. Gosh dang it, this is hard.
This is hard.
Because the thing is, I can watch Psycho any day of the week and be happy with it, but I would love to be in an audience in IMAX watching the movie Psycho.
Now, if I could give you some film history and give you a little bit more time to think.
Thank you for giving me film history, Kent.
This is not a Jacob fact either.
Let me show you my degree.
Back in the day, people would just go to movies at whatever time they started. It didn't matter. They would walk in halfway through a movie, finish the movie, and then be able to sit through the first half of the movie.
Yep.
It didn't matter. Like, people just wanted to watch a whole movie, and even though it would be out of sequence, people were generally okay. Psycho is the movie that, you know, basically Hitchcock told theater owners, don't close the door once the movie starts. Like, don't let them in halfway. They have
no
to see
admitted after the movie
from beginning to end the entire experience, because it was an experience. Mm-hmm. And so I think that should lead you on to what you're about to say.
But I'm going to have to stick with Psycho as my cable.
Oh, see, I'm surprised by that.
Because I will watch that one any day of the week. I really think Psycho...
Well, now he's seen it all, though, so that kind of changes that.
But I mean, Psycho...
Yeah,
really,
but I'm saying, like, for the first time, this is the first time you stepped out.
I love showing it to people. I showed it to my sister-in-law. She'd never heard of it.
Psycho?
Yes. She was younger. She didn't know anything about it, and I was able to show it to her,
she's
and I got to see her reaction.
She's watching Finding Nemo all the time, and you're like, hey, I got a movie for you.
She's like 18 or 19 when I showed it to her.
Hey, Satanic. Psycho Satanic.
Because there's a fly?
Yeah, they mentioned a fly.
There's a fly, you're right.
That's true.
But I'm going to say Psycho is my cable, because I'm always up for watching that. It's such a great film. Such a great film. Just perfectly made. And then Rear Window is going to be my theater, because I would love to be in a theater. I'd love to be able to see that, and the experience of watching Rear Window with a crowd would be really fun. Because that scene when she's in the house and the other guy comes home is so tense, and watching people squirm would be so much fun. And also, it's a very visual movie. I'm going to have... And then I have to erase Vertigo from existence.
You are erasing...
Man, sad.
Sight and Sound's number one movie of all time.
I know.
Vertigo.
I know. It's not easy. But I don't want to get rid of Rear Window.
See, think about it while I give my answer.
This
I'm erasing Rear Window is being erased for me. I think it is a great movie, but once you see it play out once or twice, there's really not much replay value. The performances are fun, but it's like, hey, a mystery, and then at the end of the movie, mystery solved.
The replay value is Grace Kelly, basically.
Yes,
right?
You're right. And Joel hates Jimmy Stewart, so I'm surprised he chose
that's
it.
That's a lie, and you know it, Mr. Potter.
Is that Rear Window?
No.
You know it, Raymond Burr.
You have to say Mr. Potter when you're doing a Jimmy Stewart impersonation. It's just the way...
Well, Jimmy Stewart never even made Rear Window, because he never made It's a Wonderful Life, and his career actually never took off.
And that means Disturbia was never made, and that's what makes me sad, Joel.
Oh, God. Yeah, you're really sad about that.
The remix far superior to the original.
Can I make a confession, though?
Yeah.
I don't like Vertigo as much as a lot of other people. I think it's a well-made film, but I don't think it's not my favorite Hitchcock.
How many times have you seen it?
I don't know. Handful? Five or six?
Okay, that's enough.
Yeah.
See, I would actually... Vertigo would be my cable movie, because I think it is so strange, one of the strangest of Hitchcock, that I want to watch it again and again and again to try to understand it different ways every time.
Can I... spoiler alert.
Like, I don't think it would ever get old, because I'd be like, what is going on? Why would he... No, what?
Vertigo, spoiler alert. I really do like the idea of a protagonist becoming an antagonist. I love that, how you really relate to Jimmy Stewart at the beginning, and then at the end you're like, oh my gosh, he's a monster.
Yeah.
I love that. But the movie didn't grab hold of me as it did many other people in the film.
See, I think there's so much to study in the movie that I want to constantly study the movie. Whereas Rear Window, I think the way they did it is awesome, and I love the layout of the apartment. But it's like kind of like a one- or two-time watch, and you just get the magic, and then that's it. Psycho, on the other hand, is the movie that I want to see with those crowds for the first time on the big screen.
Oh, that would be awesome.
And be shocked and scared. I mean, we're all desensitized to this kind of horror now, but back then... Holy cow.
Yeah. It's just so well made, too, because you, once again, spoiler alert for Psycho, you identify with this protagonist. You're journeying with Marion Crane.
Yeah.
And then she gets taken away. And the only person you have next to relate to is Norman Bates.
Mm-hmm.
And before you know it, you are sympathizing with the killer.
Yeah.
And you don't know it. And
Anthony Perkins does such a good job.
Really good.
Yeah, he does.
Yeah.
Man, I love that movie.
So, yeah, that's okay. So we're a little bit skewed there.
That wasn't easy. And I, truth be told, I probably could flip Vertigo and Rear Window.
So
your argument was pretty strong there, actually.
Yeah. So, Jake, I know you're a huge Hitchcock fan.
I am.
What would you choose?
Well, he likes Marnie. And
stop it.
I just like pretty much all Hitchcock. In fact, there's only one or two I don't care for.
Uh-huh.
Vertigo would definitely be the cable, because I can watch that anytime. And I can pick it up anywhere, because it's enchanting and creepy just right from the get-go. Psycho, IMAX, all the way.
Yeah.
Because, wow. And you have to do that.
But you only get it occasionally.
What?
You only get Psycho occasionally in IMAX.
Yeah, that's fine.
That's true.
The magic is there.
That's true. But it'll be worth it to see it.
Because I'm not downplaying Psycho at all. I'm saying Psycho gets the highest honor of me always wanting to watch it, and it's always on cable. If they had a Psycho channel, I'd subscribe to that.
You make a good point, honestly. But, I mean, you have to be aligned. And then Rear Window, as much as I love Rear Window, appreciate Rear Window, it doesn't quite have the same staying power for me, but...
Okay.
Yeah. Kent, Yellow Submarine.
What?
The Green Mile.
Oh, my gosh.
And The Hunt for the Red October.
For October.
So two submarine movies and The Green Mile.
Well, they're all colors.
There's the colors.
Not like Das Boot or anything like that.
It does have a color in the title.
Yeah, but that's dumb.
Yellow, no. Green, red.
Yellow, like, submarine.
Submarines would be a
mile.
Way better. The U-571 would be a better one. But it just because it's not red U-571, it doesn't exist.
I had a bunch of color movies, and those are the ones I said, that would be hard for me to do.
Okay, this is really easy for me.
Let's hear it quick.
Yellow Submarine is dead.
Whoa.
I think it's awful. I hate Beatles in that era.
How dare you?
Just drug-induced, whatever.
You are so losing my brothers.
Really? I love Yellow Submarine.
No, not too late.
Hard Day's Night is awesome.
Too late. Hard Day's Night is awesome.
No, it's not. It's terrible.
It
it's a stupid movie.
I will argue that off the air.
Sergeant Pepper's, I love... No, just kidding.
It's
you know,
not a movie.
I'm just saying the stupid era of the Beatles.
Jeez.
I don't like Yellow Submarine at all. You know, whatever.
Okay.
Not very good.
All right.
Green Mile is my cable watch. It is... It's no Shawshank, but it's still very watchable. And yeah, it's just kind of a nice movie. It's nothing to see on the big screen, though. It's just, it's a long movie that, I would just give it time on a rainy day to watch it on cable. It'd be fine.
Okay.
Which means Hunt for Red October, which is a good movie, would be my IMAX movie. The quality's not great. I mean, I can't imagine seeing, VHS quality up on IMAX.
Some things in here don't react well to bullets.
But yeah, seeing Sean Connery again, I'm not a big fan of Alec Baldwin, but as Jack Ryan, he was pretty good.
He made a great Jack Ryan.
Yeah, he was fine as Jack Ryan.
Second only to Harrison Ford.
Yeah. I mean, skinny Alec Baldwin is okay.
The shadow knows.
But yeah, that would be my IMAX movie.
All right.
Joel?
I should have done my other one. It would have been harder. I'm actually going to agree with Kent. But for
you kill Yellow Submarine?
For different reasons.
No. Say it.
No, it's for different reasons, because I like Yellow Submarine. I like that the movie. I got a kick out of it.
You also like The Monkey's Head, right?
But even... No, God. No.
Basically the same movie.
No, we talked about that in another podcast.
Yeah, we did.
Yellow Submarine, though, even if we get rid of the movie, we still have the album, and that's fine. Because the album was not from the movie was from the album.
That's like all Ringo's fault. That's like a Ringo fault era for the Beatles. Octopus's Garden.
I'm going to say Green Mile is my cable.
Yeah.
Because when it is on, I will stop and watch it. It's kind of that Shawshank.
Oh, you kind of go, I wish I was watching Shawshank right now, but there are good performances in this movie.
No, but what's his bucket? The creepy-looking dude. What's his name?
Not Sam Rockwell's in that movie.
No, not Sam Rockwell. It's the one that the really creepy one. Percy in the movie.
Yes.
I can't remember his name right now. He married that really young girl. He was in X-Files.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
He just is so awful in that movie. It's a great portrayal because you really hate Percy.
Yes.
And then Hunt for October is going to be my IMAX because... It's a big movie, mm-hmm. and there are big things going on, and I would love to see that in the theaters.
Yeah.
So.
Shaun of the Dead.
Oh, come on.
Slumdog Millionaire.
This is unfair.
The Dark Knight. That doesn't mean one to end with.
I mean, do you see why I was so excited to share this one?
But it's ridiculous because you're making me make hard decisions.
Oh, I have to answer this one, too. Like, I don't want to answer this one.
Yeah.
Shaun of the Dead, Slumdog Millionaire, which, by the way, Joel loves, in case people don't know.
It's like his favorite thing
ever. These are all five-star movies.
Keep in mind, Slumdog Millionaire and Dark Knight came out the same year, 2008.
Yep.
Both were great movies. Dark Knight was not nominated for the Best Picture
at all. Neither was Shaun of the Dead. Neither was Shaun of the Dead.
No, Shaun of the Dead was 2004.
Right.
But Slumdog Millionaire won that year, and many people say like that Christopher Nolan was basically robbed that year, and the Oscars really messed it up. Joel would argue that Slumdog Millionaire was the superior movie of the year, but now I want to know your favorite comedy.
Yep.
Then Slumdog Millionaire.
My favorite drama. My favorite action.
And then Dark Knight. I knew this would be tough.
It is tough.
I hope it's a little tough.
It is tough, but Shaun of the Dead is my cable.
Okay,
I can, if that one's on the TV or I watch it every year, I've watched that one probably more than
how many times exactly?
I don't know. I don't know. Probably about 108.
All right, now I see what I sound like. Probably maybe 37.
Yes. So Shaun of the Dead is going to be my cable. Dark Knight is going to be the IMAX.
Yeah. Yes.
I'm going to have to get rid of Slumdog Millionaire.
That means your favorite Danny Boyle movie.
Yeah.
In fact, I don't know if I know of a movie that you've talked more highly of, more consistently than Slumdog
Millionaire. It's so uplifting. But
you're like president of the Slumdog fan club.
Me and the Academy.
Yeah, the Academy. What do they know?
But that was hard.
Remember when Joel got rid of all the happy movies? It's a Wonderful Life, dead to me. Slumdog Millionaire, dead to me.
Remember when you
Master of Disguise, dead.
Oh, God. I'm not going to think about it anymore. I have to just do it. Okay. Away. I have to walk away.
So that's your Spielberg one. For me, I totally agree, but it's a much easier decision. Shaun of the Dead is instantly rewatchable. The movie is so good and funnier every time you watch it. It's crazy. The inside jokes, the references that the Edgar Wright throws in there for the watchful eye is awesome. Dark Knight is clearly an IMAX movie, one of the great IMAX movies. So much fun to watch. Slumdog Millionaire is not as good as the other two.
Whoa!
Not nearly.
We're not saying that.
Not nearly.
But I think that is what you said, Joel.
No.
You erased it. It's gone. Yeah. I mean, I don't even have to mention it because it's erased.
I love Slumdog. Maybe I'll erase The Dark Knight.
You know. Don't do it out of spite.
I think you should have done that. That would have been funny upset.
Because I just saw something about The Dark Knight last night or the night before, and I was just like, oh, I got to watch that again. I love that movie.
All right. Okay, so we're plenty on time. So I'm just going to tell you two other ones.
No, don't give them away.
I just wanted you to know.
No, don't give them away. What are you doing?
It's fine. It's just a funny note to end on. So Must Love Dogs, All Dogs Go to Heaven, and Reservoir Dogs. Right? That'd have been a good one, right? Also, Joel had a good one, which was The Incredibles, The Incredible Hulk, and Homeward Bound, The Incredible Journey.
That's what I should have done instead of the colors one.
Dogs drool, cats rule, you know?
Yeah, yeah. Anyway, okay.
Oh, go for hole.
So that's it. So thank you for listening, everybody. Hope you've enjoyed this game. Let us know what matchups you'd like to see.
Yeah, let us know on Baconsale.com or on Twitter. We're at Baconsale. Or on Facebook, just search for Baconsale.
Yeah. And thanks for all the love. Like, you know, these shows are fun to do, but when we get your interaction, that's the best part.
We'd love to know when we've hit a nerve.
Yeah, and if you'd like to see this episode again, you know, a sequel
not
to it.
Not this specific one, yeah.
Yeah, a sequel to it. Let us know and give us those matchups because we can do it. Put Joel and Kent in a weird position.
With the cable IMAX-y race.
Yep.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah. So you could find me on my website, showtimeshowdown.com, Twitter and Instagram. I'm Kenny3DD based off Piranha 3DD, as we discussed.
Yes.
Joel?
You can find me. I perform with Quickwits. They perform every Saturday night at 10 o'clock at the Midbuild Performing Arts Center. I'm also on Twitter at 786 Joel.
You can find me on Twitter at Jacob A. Rogers. Thank you so much for listening. And
until next time, this has been Baconsale.
This has been Baconsale. Thank you for listening. It's enchanting and creepy just right from the get-go.
I think it's you were always like a really nice kid.
Shut up! Samara skydiving?
That's a sequel.
That was one of you?
That was me.
Jacob, you sadist.
I know.
I'm not buying this. I am buying The Ring, though, on DVD.
I would erase Remember the Titans.
But you're supposed to remember them.
I guess I care about hockey for 2 days.
So, sorry, Denzel. Nothing happened in there. Thumb sucking in the fetal position. This is the most beautiful sight these eyes have ever seen. I'll just shut my eyes during that part.
See, I'm killing Jurassic Park.
Whoa!
I'm so sorry.
You know what? I'm going to erase Diver Mad Black Woman from existence, because that will make me happy.
So you chose
that's a lie, and you know it, Mr. Potter!
Oh. You ruined Christmas.
I know, right? Like,
I really did.
No angels are getting their wings now. Put Joel and Kent in a weird position. Basically, you're a monster.